Good morning. It's Sunday, March 29th. It is the fifth Sunday of Lent. And James and I welcome you to our worship on Facebook Live, which will be later downloaded on YouTube. James, what's happening this week? Well, first, let me say, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Well, so you're still doing the Book of Joy class. If you are part of that, we have two more weeks left. Look for the Zoom link in your email, and then all you want to do is a Zoom. And we will be, as Pastor Ben has said, we will be uploading these videos to our new YouTube channel. You are able to find that at FUMC Medford OR on YouTube. We will probably put this one up tomorrow, but look for it this week.
We're gonna upload it this afternoon.
Okay.
So people can actually see us on Sunday if they don't have Facebook.
Very nice.
And they'll get an email with a link.
Okay, great. And then our food pantry will reopen Wednesday from 1 to 3. We've been doing is handing out bags of food to the community, so we're following social distance guidelines, but it is here if you need it. And don't forget to watch us live on Tuesday. Pastor Ben will bring a devotional at 1 p.m. And on Thursday, I will also bring a devotional at 1 p.m. So that'll be a Facebook Live and also uploaded to our YouTube channel after that. So that's it.
We'll play a little music and center ourselves for prayer.
So now we are going to pray for one another, or Pastor Ben is going to lead us in prayer. We have the opportunity through Facebook Live to include your prayer requests as part of our prayers of the people, and I am happy to mention them as we get to that portion. However, there is a small lag in the video, so if you have prayer requests, feel free to include them. And when we get to that part, if I see the prayer requests, we will add them to our prayers. So go ahead, Pastor Ben.
Let us pray. Gracious Lord, who is the creator of all that is, and the redeemer of the earth, renew us this day. Lift our burdens. Ease our minds, settle our spirits, and give us the peace we desire. We trust you that all will be well. For the leaders of the world, give them the will and the wisdom to be servants of the people. Where there is malice, may they repent. Where there is privilege, may they be generous. Where there is too much power in the hands of the few, may our leaders be humble before you. We bring before you all those who are afraid of losing employment, and any who fear not being able to pay the rent or mortgage. For those who fear they won't have enough to pay for the groceries. Be present with us in this time of uncertainty. And give us the peace we desire. We trust you that all will be well. For the least of our society, for any for whom you said, when we serve them, we are serving you. May your church find ways to be present with the hungry, the unsheltered, the stranger, the sick and the imprisoned, the lonely. During this time of separation from one another, social distancing, may your church be with the lonely and the isolated. May we who are the church be present for one another. Give us the peace we desire. We trust you that all will be well. For scientists and public servants as they work toward our safety and health, in this time of contagion, for doctors and nurses that are on the front lines of this disease, watch over them. Bring calm to your people. And guide us that we would discover ways to be a place of refuge, the church. Give us the peace we desire. We trust you that all will be well. And for those who have been entrusted to our care, for any this day who suffer of body, mind, or spirit, for their healing and restoration. And now, here are the names of your people. Do we have any posts, James?
We have one so far. Barbara Geisler says, let's remember Cindy Patterson in our prayers as she begins her transition from this world, and may she forever ring those handbells with the angels. Amen.
Amen. We can also remember my daughter, who's a doctor and working long hours right now. And is young, and for her safety.
Yeah, and I guess her, but also there's a number of healthcare workers in our community too that we should
continue. Healthcare workers, yeah, in the church and in this community. Very good.
I noticed on the Tuesday broadcast that we missed a prayer request because it came in right at the tail end of your video, but Lavelle was concerned about her family that lives in the Seattle area. So we'll lift them up as well.
Well, James, will you lead us in the Lord's Prayer?
I will. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
We'll take a moment to listen to some music.
Image of a living Savior.
A couple more prayer requests I want to mention as they came in while we were meditating. Prayers for Tom Okerlund as he receives test results from CAT scans and MRI results. That's from Kathy Okerlund. And Karen Bassett says a prayer of thanksgiving for those making gowns, masks, head covers to protect workers and families at Southern Oregon Pediatrics. So.
Even in this time of job loss and concern, we do want to mention the work of the church and our tithe and offering. We can continue to give to the church through PayPal. You can go onto the church website, churchoftherogue.org, and go to the hub as a way of giving. You can also give through the classic you can send us a letter if you'd like, but you can send a check to the church that we might continue our work here in this historic church in the center of town. James, you're going to read the passage for us.
Yes, and our passage today comes from Matthew chapter 25, and I'm reading verses 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, and he will sit on the throne in his glory, all the nations will be gathered before him. And he will separate people one from another as shepherds separate the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did one of the least of these, who are members of my family, you did it for me." Then he will say to those on his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" And he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it for one of the least of these, you did not do it for me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
I'll read one of those verses again. "And when was it we saw you sick and in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer, "Truly I tell you, when you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it for me." I'd like to begin by saying that I think goats get a bad rap in this parable. Yes, goats will tear up your garden, they'll eat your shoes, and if your car is parked for long enough, well, even if it's not parked, if it just stopped for a moment, they'll climb all over it. I've had it happen. But I've never met an animal with more personality than a goat. I mean, sheep, on the other hand, rarely look you in the face. sheep keep their heads down and they eat and they wander away and get themselves lost or caught in the thicket. Goats, on the other hand, they're trailblazers and they'll eat the thicket. We count sheep at night to fall asleep. We don't count goats because, well, they would wake us up. They're rambunctious. They have energy and personality. So I think maybe goats are getting a bad rap. I say all this to say that in the parable, folks don't know if they're sheep or they're goats until the end of the story. Common title of this parable is The Judgment of the Nations. Sounds ominous. Until the end, they don't know who's on the right side of Jesus and inherits the kingdom, and they don't know who ends up on the left side of Jesus and is sent to eternal punishment. And when the sheep are feeding the hungry, welcoming the stranger, clothing the naked, caring for the sick, visiting the prisoner, they have no clue they're doing it for Jesus. They ask, when did we do this? Which makes the point that being on the right side of Jesus is a life of humility. The sheep weren't necessarily better informed than the goats. They didn't have an inside track on religion. It's not that they had the right doctrine or the right political views. They simply did the right thing. They tended to the family of God, which were the hungry, the thirsty, the unsheltered, the lonely, the sick, the imprisoned, the stranger. They cared for the least, last, and lost of our society. So, there's nothing about right belief in the judgment of the nations, of people. Which is to say, if your belief isn't making you more warm-hearted and a loving person, well, you might want to question how it's forming you, what you believe. Read carefully the teachings of Jesus. Know the Gospels. Because so much of what we hear people saying Jesus said, he didn't actually say. So, pay attention. The other day, I was taking a trip to Eastern Oregon, which is the most starkly beautiful and desolate places I have ever been. We drove for miles and miles and didn't see a soul. It was social distancing by force, by geography. There was no one around. We were in the high desert surrounded by marshland and open land, and the radio reception was scant. And we found ourselves listening to a preacher give his lesson. Now, the fellow sounded sincere, and he was full of passion. The trouble was, what he said didn't really reflect what Jesus said. When he came to the topic of possessions and, well, violence and guns, because what did Jesus say about our possessions? If you have two coats, give away one. Do not resist an evildoer. Well, might be tough to live by, but that is the teachings of Jesus. So, does what you say about Jesus and the cross, or what you believe about Jesus and the cross, well, is it really what Jesus said? Is it full of grace or judgment? Does it open your heart up or does it shut it down? Does your faith cause you to be more generous or create fear? Where this parable is placed in the Gospel of Matthew holds significance. This is Jesus' last teaching before he'll enter into Jerusalem, be arrested, tried, and nailed to the cross. In a sense, it is Jesus' closing argument, a kind of summary for his life and teachings. The closing line in the parable reads, Lord, when was it we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you? And the king will say to them, truly I tell you, as you did it for the least of these, you did it for me. Jesus' closing argument. It appears to be that that's what matters most to him. You know, there are a few lines in the Sermon on the Mount, which also takes place in the Gospel of Matthew, right there in the very beginning. And the Sermon on the Mount is like an introduction to what's going to take place later in the Gospels. It's a preamble of sorts of what we're going to hear. And what are a few lines there? Well, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. If you want to know the will of God, turn to this parable. So it's not a question of information, of knowing what to do with our lives. It's a question of, well, doing it, of, well, obedience, Now, obedience sounds like a harsh word, and yet that's how he divides the sheep and the goats, those on his left and those on his right, those who inherit the kingdom and those who don't. Yeah, it's loving your neighbor. And then there's this line that follows in the Sermon on the Mount. Beware of false prophets who come to you dressed in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. The sheep does the will of the Father. You will know them by their fruits. You don't need to know their doctrine or their church affiliation or their bank account. Well, it's not necessary to have a slick presentation. We kind of know this with Facebook Live, don't we, James? You will know them by their fruit, a sheep. Mother Teresa based her whole life on work on this idea that when we tend to the sick and the suffering, we're actually tending to Jesus. And the whole world knew her by her fruit, by what she did. She was a Catholic nun and held to the teachings and doctrines of the Catholic Church. And that's not what made her life legend. We knew her by her fruit. What she did was a statement. The way she lived her life held integrity. And this is a particularly poignant lesson in the age of the coronavirus, with all the fear and anxiety that has gripped our communities. You will know us by our fruits. You will know us by our fruits at this time in which we live. Not by our house or our address or by the clothes we wear or the car we drive. You won't really know us by what we say or the doctrine of our church. In times of crisis, you know us by our fruits. Do we do the will of a loving God? Are we finding ways to tend to the poor, the hungry, the thirsty, the stranger, the sick, the prisoner, the elderly, the lonely? The passage in the Sermon on the Mount continues. Are grapes gathered from thorns or figs from thistles? In the same way, every good tree bears good fruit and every bad tree bears bad fruit. How will you know us in the coming days? Will you know us by our fruit? By good fruit. It's also telling that when Jesus is crucified, he becomes the very one that he's talking about in this parable. He is naked, thirsty, hungry, and sick. He becomes the prisoner. He is the stranger on the cross. He's hardly recognizable. The trick of the gospel is that it holds out grace, but it's also difficult to escape the glare of its judgment. By this I mean, it's so easy to see ourselves as sheep and everyone else, well, others as a goat. Rarely does someone read this parable and say, well, I'm definitely a goat. But we are goats. Jesus is unrecognizable on the cross. He looks nothing like a son of God or Messiah. He doesn't look anything like an anointed one. He doesn't look like God's favored one. Crucifixions in that time in the Roman Empire were common, and Jesus looks like every other rebel or powerless dissident who had been nailed and hung on a cross. He looked like the thieves that were hung on either side of him. He was weak and dying, and but for a few women, everyone had fled the scene or yelled, "Crucify him," or denied him, including the disciples. Peter, who had swore to himself and to Jesus that if anything ever happened to Jesus, he would stand by his side. But in the end, it is true. You will know them by their fruits. Wolves dressed in sheep's clothing. Everyone, almost everyone in that story, well, becomes a goat. Are we goats? You know, in closing, there's an Old Testament story that is, well, similar to what we're talking about here. It sheds light on it. David is the king of Israel, and he has achieved greatness and wealth. He is a beloved leader. Nathan is a prophet of Israel at the time, which is to say, he is the voice of wisdom, even the voice of God. He is the king's conscience. He ribs him and makes him look at himself, makes David look at himself when he would rather not. Nathan tells King David a story about a rich man who had many flocks and herds, and a poor man who had one little ewe lamb that he had bought. He raised the ewe like it was his child, his companion. He shared the little food he had with his little lamb. There came a traveler to the rich man that the rich man was compelled to entertain. The rich man was loath to take from the abundance of his own flock to entertain him, to feed him. So he took the little lamb from the poor man's flock and prepared that for the guest to receive him. When David heard the story from Nathan, he was filled with all this righteous indignation. As the Lord lives, he said, this man deserves to be punished. And then there's that well-known, famous line in that passage. Nathan replies, you are the man. Because David had done something similar. The details were different, and so was the setting. But the similarities are apparent. David is unable to see himself in this story. And that's the point. It's actually the point of the whole gospel, which is not that we point to others in disbelief at their poor behavior, but we see ourselves. Then seeing ourselves, we offer ourselves to the grace of God and his renewing efforts on our lives. Once again, note the title of the parable, The Judgments of the Nations. The Judgment of the Nations, it sounds so scary. And notice the wording to those who fail to clothe, feed, shelter, and tend to the least, the last, and the lost of our society. It's kind of harsh. You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Take it for the imagery that it is, and remember that it is meant to jolt you. It's meant to disturb you, to make you uncomfortable. It's meant to call us up short, so that we are compelled to do the thing, the one thing that we are sure the Father of Heaven, or Mother Earth, or Jesus wants from us. What is that? To love our neighbor, whoever that might be. So do you want to know the will of God for your life in this time of anxiety and social separation, of a virus that takes lives? Well, look no further than Matthew 25. Tend to your neighbor. This is how we do something beautiful. Be creative. Be safe, but be daring. Be generous. Find simple ways to tend to the lonely and the suffering. And so, may the Lord watch over you. May Jesus, our brother, walk beside you. And the Holy Spirit be within you. Amen.
Amen.
In closing, I do want to inform you that the bishop has suspended worship in our United Methodist congregations through April, right, James? And we will find ways to stay connected. Fortunately, we have a social media and we'll continue to use that. Once again, our service will be downloaded onto YouTube and we'll send out an email to the congregation where they'll just have to click the link and the service will be available. Our prayers are with one another. We'll celebrate Holy Week. I guess you'll be doing the meditation on Holy Thursday,
mm-hmm.
right? And we'll find ways to celebrate Palm Sunday. Be creative. I understand Robbie Crowell has is doing pen pals with the children and our older adults to reach out and foster those relationships. If you have ideas, email us or call us. We are always open to your thoughts and creativity in a way that we can be the church at this time. All right. Take care of yourselves. Take care of those you love. And, well, even take care of those who have difficult loving. Bye-bye.